Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Still Life with Brook Trout by John Gierach, narrated by David Colacci. We should be grateful for impermanence and the freedom it grants us. Gary Snyder. Chapter 1. Vince Zaunick and I had pulled off the road on a wooded pass for one of those stops that are made necessary by a long drive and too much coffee. This was an ideal spot to pee. You could easily get out of sight of the road to avoid offending anyone who drove by, and to the east there was a fine view of receding peaks, the farther mountains still purple in the cloudy morning light. We'd stopped at this same pretty spot plenty of times on previous trips up this road, but apparently not often enough to kill the grass. As we walked back toward his pickup, Vince said, "Uh-oh," in the kind of non-committal tone of voice that could have meant anything from an untied shoelace to a charging bull. Turns out he was referring to the steaming green pool of radiator fluid that was growing under the front bumper of his truck. I've always enjoyed being on the road, even at times like this, because the usual complications of life suddenly boil down to simply getting where you're going, in this case to a little trout stream in Wyoming that we'd never fished before. The big, uncertain future you're always worrying about shrinks to the time it takes to get to the creek, and then unexpectedly shrinks again to the distance between a mountain pass and the nearest radiator shop, which we guessed at about 20 miles. Most of that distance was downhill, but while the temperature gauge wasn't quite pegged, it was dangerously high. Vince said, "What do you think? Can we make it without seizing up?" I said, "It's your truck, man," trying to be as helpful as possible without accepting any responsibility. A few miles down the road, the engine temperature had actually cooled slightly, and Vince was puzzled by that. I explained that when a vehicle stops, the cooling system shuts down and the temperature climbs from the stored heat of the engine. Once you're moving, the coolant begins to circulate again, and even when there isn't much of it left, it still makes a difference. I was channeling my late father here. Internal combustion engines are actually one of my weak points. Vince enjoyed that. I like traveling with him because he's the kind of guy who can take the time to appreciate an interesting new fact, even when the larger picture looks grim. I was smiling over the idea that something my dad told me when I was a kid had popped out 40-some years later sounding like wisdom. The temperature hovered just inside the red as we coasted down off the pass, and for the next few miles we were unreasonably happy. The guy at the radiator shop in town said it was just a cracked hose. He had the part and could get right to it, so we killed some time drinking coffee and wandering Main Street in the kind of wind that snatches your hat and sandblasts your face. The question about wind in Wyoming isn't will it blow, but rather how hard and from which direction. I've learned that when I cross the Colorado line into Wyoming, I have to ditch the brimmed fishing hat, never mind the sunburned ears, and screw on a baseball cap adjusted one size too small. When we went to pick up the truck, the man in front of us at the counter had a squirrel sitting on his shoulder, a fat one that had apparently lived a pampered life in captivity. This is the kind of thing that doesn't quite register at first. You have to stop and say to yourself, "That man has a live fox squirrel on his shoulder." The squirrel turned out to be friendly enough, in the excitable way of a critter that will never be completely tame, not unlike the human he was with, actually. When I tried to make up to the squirrel, he immediately hopped onto my shoulder and started nuzzling around like we were old friends. Vince said, "You've always had a way with animals." I said, "Yeah, but I also have an open bag of peanuts in my jacket." When the man and his squirrel left, the radiator guy looked after them and said, "No one in that whole family is quite right." We were on our way again by noon. We'd only gone a few miles out of our way, and we'd only lost an hour and a half of fishing time. But it was early in the season, when morning fishing isn't that good anyway. Not bad as breakdowns go. All in all, this is how it had been going for the last couple of seasons. Things hadn't been working out perfectly, but they'd been working out. The stretch of stream we had permission to fish ran across a wide, flat valley of hay meadows bordered by low foothills. A minor range of the Rocky Mountains was just barely visible to the west as a line of uneven gray bumps on the horizon. If you didn't already know it was there, you might not even notice it. The creek was downstream of a wedge-shaped irrigation dam that split an already small stream into two smaller channels, and at first glance it was hard to tell which was the original watercourse and which was the ditch. We guessed that the right fork was the actual stream, because what we could see of it wandered off in wide meanders, while the left fork took a 45-degree dogleg and then went straight. Real streams meander because they're in no particular hurry. Ditches go straight because they are. We walked a few hundred yards down that right fork and found distinct pools and riffles, a few still active spring seeps, and stands of old, gnarled river birch that had gotten plenty of sun and water, but were as stubby and contorted as bonsai trees from living in a constant wind. This had to be it. A quarter mile across the meadow, we could see the other channel. It was lined in scrubby willows, and it ran as straight as a city street. The flow in the stream was low for May, and in fact, it would have seemed a little low even for August or September. In a normal year, any stream in this country would have been in the early stages of runoff, maybe even too high and muddy to fish. But it had been yet another dry winter, so maybe this was all the snow melt there was. But then we'd sort of counted on that. Normally, you'd never drive 100 miles to try out a new stream in May. You'd go in early April, hoping to slip in before the spring runoff began, or wait until sometime in late June or even early July when it came down. But over the previous two drought seasons, the usual timing had slipped a few gears. Now, May could be a good month to fish a new stream. In many drainages up and down the Front Range, the slug of snowmelt that was usually a seasonal flood had been no more than relief from the low flows of winter, and since there was less of it, the water warmed more quickly toward the high 40s, the temperature that starts the aquatic insects moving around and the trout feeding. Of course, in a strange creek half a dozen drainages north of home, it was a guess, but no more of a guess than when the runoff would come up or go down in another kind of year. Still, it was something to go on. One of the charms of fishing is that it's always a gamble. But then one of the charms of gambling is that you can use what you think you know to play the odds. Some make obscene amounts of money doing things like that with stocks, bonds, and hog futures. Others just manage to catch a few trout. The stream was lower than we expected it to be, but we thought we'd still figured it right. We just hadn't counted on that headgate taking a third of its flow to flood irrigate hayfields. For that matter, there would be other ranches upstream between there and the mountains, each with its own water rights, and they'd probably done the same thing. Once upon a time, rivers and creeks converged and grew as they flowed downstream. Now they split and shrink. It's one more example of how things can go sideways when humans are in charge. Somewhere up there, above the last ranches and headgates in the National Forest, this creek was probably running a reasonably healthy head of water, the drought notwithstanding. The fishing that day turned out to be pretty tough. Most of the stream ran thin and ankle deep, although the water was still cold and there was still enough of it to make the riffles sound like distant laughter. There were some glassy, slow-moving, fishy-looking pools here and there that would have been a challenge to fish even on a calm day, but the wind was blowing so hard that casting was an additional struggle. This was the kind of situation where you needed a heavy 9-foot, 9-weight rod to make the cast, and a delicate little 7-foot, 4-weight to fish the fly. If I remember right, we were both fishing 5-weights. At least it was cloudy, which would make the trout a little less spooky, and the wind was ruffling the water enough to cover the less-than-perfect casts we were making. On a calm, bright day, this would approach being impossible. As it was, this would only be difficult. In most places, the only way to get a quiet cast and drift was to slam a dry fly and a dropper at the head of a pool against the upstream wind, make a big mend, hold your rod tip lower to keep the wind from whipping the line around, and then let it slowly snake down into the sweet spot. Sometimes we'd do this from our knees to keep our silhouettes low. Sometimes we'd cast to the current 20 feet above a pool, crawl downstream on our hands and knees behind the slowly floating fly, and then lie on our stomachs to fish out the drift. Once you've decided to do serious stealth, you can hardly go too far. There's the temptation to stick twigs in your hat so you look like a bush. It could take several minutes to fish out a drift in the lazy current, and during these almost cinematic slow-motion scenes, it was possible to get distracted by a deer crossing a meadow, or a circling hawk, and miss a strike when it finally came. And in that glassy water, the commotion caused by missing a strike could mean you'd buggered the pool. We caught a handful of fish that afternoon, and they all came hard, but more because of the wind, the agonizing drifts, and being asleep at the wheel when the takes came than from any real skittishness on the fish's part. There was no hatch to speak of, but the creek had warmed up early, so there were a few odd caddisflies, mayflies, and craneflies around. These trout wanted a good, natural-looking drift in the right spot, but they hadn't been fished for enough to have gotten too picky about flies. Our first guesses at what the right fly might be worked well enough, and we each picked different patterns. These were fat, healthy-looking brown trout, butter yellow with brown backs, bottomless black spots, and that hint of iridescent sky blue on their gill covers, and some were surprisingly big. I got one that was around 16 inches long and missed a bigger one when my attention strayed during a 5-minute drift and I forgot to set the hook. Vince landed one that he measured against his net handle at a fraction over 19 inches. These would have been good-sized trout anywhere, but they seemed even bigger coming out of low water in a small creek. We were proud of ourselves. It was more than we'd expected, but in the way of fishermen everywhere, not exactly more than we'd hoped for. That had pretty much been our experience as fly fishermen living through the past 2 years of drought. We'd tried a little harder and done better than we expected, sometimes even better than usual, even though the drought was having undeniably real effects on the streams and rivers in the West. Summer rains and winter snows had both been way below the 30-year average they call normal, and the dry winters had been especially worrisome, since the region gets more than 80% of its water from melting snow running out of the high mountains. Water providers, who make millions selling water and for whom there will never be enough, had been howling about how we needed more dams for storage, so we could go on wasting water even in drought conditions. But then they also howl for dams in wet years, for flood controls, and in normal years to provide more water for growth. By now, this has become little more than a kind of background noise, but they do turn up the volume during extreme conditions when it's easier to incite panic. Guides and fly shop owners were worried because business was down, although the more established outfits thought they'd weather the drought okay as long as it didn't go on forever, by which they meant another year or two. Some even said that the slow seasons would flush some of the dead wood out of the fishing business, although none of those in danger of getting flushed out thought of themselves as dead wood. And naturally, those fishermen with a tendency toward hysteria were making the usual dire predictions of the end of fishing as we know it. I can't say I was completely unconcerned myself, but in the 35 years I've lived in the region, I'd seen 5 multi-year droughts and about that many flood years, enough to begin to see that a normal year was more the exception than the rule. I'd also heard many doomsday predictions, none of which quite came to pass. It's true that some lakes and reservoirs were down and some streams and rivers were running thin, but the catastrophe seemed to be less real and more a matter of definition. That is, there was less water than some people wanted, but there was no less water than there was supposed to be, or than there had been off and on for as far back as records had been kept. The Front Range of the Rockies has a semi-arid climate, where the air routinely gets dry enough to evaporate the ice cubes in your freezer, and in some places there are already more people than there is water to support them, especially since many insist on growing exotic, water-guzzling trees and lawns. The drought was a problem because we were already asking more from the environment than it was able to give, so the unavoidable question had to be, if the habitat we've chosen to live in is doing what it's always done, and we call that a disaster, what does that say about us? The all-too-common answer was, we don't care what it says, we just want to water our lawns. Living gracefully in any kind of natural environment takes patience and acceptance, the two qualities we Americans have pretty much bred out of ourselves. As for the fishing, it had held up well enough so far. Some of the mountain lakes we fished had dropped a little, but they still seemed fine. The untouched streams, those above the last dams and cutoffs, were running at the thin end of normal, but they also seemed fine. In fact, the low runoff had added a month to the beginning of the high country season, and the insect hatches had been starting early and staying late. It was mostly the man-made fisheries, the reservoirs and tailwaters, that were taking the hit. And since those were the most popular places with the biggest trout and the biggest crowds, things looked worse than they were. In some canyon streams, the drought had actually helped the trout. When spring runoff comes down a steep-sided canyon, the stream doesn't spread out and get wider as it would in flatter country. It just gets deeper and faster, making it harder for the trout to feed and messing up the reds of spring-spawning rainbows and cutthroats. Low runoff lengthens the fish's growing season and makes life easier for young trout, which can feed more easily in slower currents. According to a Colorado Division of Wildlife study, after 2 drought years, the trout biomass in the Arkansas River had doubled, and the number of trout over 14 inches had increased 8-fold. Rafting companies on the Arkansas were hurting because there wasn't enough high water for their usual paid thrill rides, but fishermen had an extra month of dry fly fishing, and by all accounts, they didn't miss rafts filled with squealing tourists paddling through the water they were trying to fish. You try not to wish hard times on people who work for a living, if only because ill will can come back to bite you, but in this case it was possible to not lose any sleep over it. From what I could see, the low runoff was also helping many of the small streams at higher altitudes that were too obscure or too remote to rate their own studies. For every low-altitude creek that was surviving but a little too thin to fish, there was another higher up that was doing beautifully, with adequate flows and fatter trout. There may have been fewer places to fish than usual, but with news of the drought in the West making national headlines, the crowds of tourist fly fishers had thinned out, and even some residents stayed home, preferring to believe the drought coverage in newspapers and on TV instead of going out to see for themselves. That meant that those of us who did go out had more water to ourselves. Of course, it's hard to be completely immune to a media-induced panic, if only because the media orchestrate those so effectively. And there were days when I wondered if I should worry more. But then I naturally went on to wonder what good worrying would do. I was catching fish, which is central to any fisherman's view of reality, and I was even getting pretty adept at casting delicately in slower water. This is the kind of thing we've all learned to live with in recent years. You're on orange alert, but there's nothing you can do about it. So you go about your life, as per the administration's instructions, now and then glancing over your shoulder without quite knowing what you expect to see. This will probably never seem quite right, but it does feel progressively less insane as time goes by. We were a good 2 miles down that creek in Wyoming when we stopped to watch a huge flock of red-winged blackbirds come stalling and skidding in on the wind and land in the upper branches of a grove of river birch. It was late in the day, and the birds were coming into roost, looking like fluttering black leaves sprouting in the still bare trees and making their usual springtime racket that sounded like 200 screen doors with rusty hinges about to slam. Redwings are among my dozen or so favorite birds. I've carefully arranged it so that all my favorites are locally common. That way I get to see them often, and the world seems friendlier. We looked at the sky, and then at our watches, and saw that there was enough daylight left to walk back out without running into something in the dark. And there'd been plenty to run into. Fallen trees, a dead harrow camouflaged by rust and weeds, snarls of barbed wire hidden in tall grass. There were dozens of accidents waiting to happen to someone who couldn't see what he was doing. On the walk back, we decided to add this stream to the dozens of others that we wouldn't worry about just yet. It had held out through some drought years already, and would probably continue to hold out unless things got worse. When the little bit of runoff there was flushed out later in the year, the water would drop even more, but by then irrigation season would be over and the headgates would be closed, so although there'd be less water, more of it would stay in the stream. Over the last few years, that had apparently been enough to grow and support some big brown trout. That may have been largely accidental as far as the rancher was concerned, but it had still worked out okay for the fish. And anyway, it's easy to criticize ranchers for siphoning off streams to grow hay, but it gets a little harder when you remember that hay feeds cattle, and you eat beef and wear leather, and then it gets harder still when the guy gives you permission to fish and you catch some big ones. When you step back even a little bit to get a slightly larger view, moral clarity is harder to come by, and your sense of outrage gets diluted by your own complicity. Things could have been better, but when the trout survive, life can't be all bad. Back at the truck at dusk, we both stopped to look under the front bumper, but there was no puddle of radiator fluid, not even a little wet spot from slow drip. We had a long drive ahead of us, and for the immediate future at least, things looked promising. Chapter 2. Jim Babb met me at the airport in Bangor, Maine, and asked, as you're supposed to ask to be polite, how was your flight? I said, the flight was fine, but I must have been randomly profiled in Denver because security was a bitch. For about 15 minutes, I was the prime suspect. At least I wasn't cavity searched. The answer to how was your flight can be a lot longer now than it once was. At its worst, it's like saying, how are you, to a hypochondriac. Then, as we walked toward an escalator, I asked, so how's it look? Jim said, well, not great. My heart did not sink. When you travel to fish, you hear that often enough, and you're expected to take it like a man, as we used to say. It doesn't always turn out to be true, anyway. Anything can happen on the water, including the good stuff. And even when it is true, it's still just fishing. It's not like a death sentence or anything. We rode the escalator down to the baggage carousel and stood around with 60 or 70 other passengers like gamblers around a roulette wheel. We'd all bet that our luggage would arrive when we did. Now we were waiting to see if we were right. There are no guarantees on travel any more than there are on fishing. There are only degrees of likelihood. The plan was to drive north, meet Paul Guernsey and Dave Gallipoli at a cabin on Frost Pond, and fish a nearby river for landlocked salmon, a fish I'd heard about but had never caught. But conditions had been weird. There'd been a serious drought in Maine the previous winter, not unlike the one back home in Colorado, except that theirs had been followed by the coldest, rainiest spring since the 1860s. Enough rain fell to more than break their drought, which was good, but it was also enough to swell the rivers and chill the water, which was bad because landlocked salmon fishing is all about flow and temperature. Landlocked salmon are just what the name says. Atlantic salmon that are landlocked in fresh water, so that instead of running out to the ocean to grow big on shrimp and herring, they run to deep lakes and get somewhat less large but still plump on forage fish like smelt. Aside from that technicality, they're either just like Atlantic salmon or they are Atlantic salmon, depending on whom you ask. By all accounts, a 20-inch landlock weighing close to 3 pounds is considered a good one, at the high end of normal and full of fight, and in most places, anything over 5 pounds could be the fish of a lifetime. At least that's what Dr. Robert Behnke says in his beautiful and authoritative book, Trout and Salmon of North America. Although I've talked to fishermen from the Northeast who claim to regularly catch them up to 8 and 10 pounds. And they can get bigger. Behnke cites historical reports of landlocks from Lake Ontario weighing over 40 pounds, but those would have been amazing fish even back in the good old days, and that population is now said to be extinct. Landlocks are essentially lake fish, they're also called lake salmon, but they swim up the rivers to feed in the spring when the water rises and warms. Later, they drop back into the lakes to wait out the heat of summer, then run back up the rivers when the water cools in the fall to feed again for a while and then spawn. They're not technically anadromous because they don't go to salt water, but the effect on the fishing is the same. You wade into a landlocked salmon river knowing that, in the grand scheme of things, the fish are more likely to be absent than present. We inland fishermen have trouble grasping that. There are plenty of days when we can't catch fish, even though we know they're in there and we might even be able to see one now and then. But the idea that an entire population could be altogether elsewhere is troubling. But your one advantage with landlocks is that, unlike sea-run Atlantic salmon, they eat while they're in the rivers. You fish for them the way you would for trout, sometimes with streamers, sometimes with whatever dry flies or nymphs seem right at the time. On the long drive north, Jim said, "They're just like Atlantic salmon, except they bite for reasons you can understand." He also said, "Fishing for landlocked salmon is like scale model Atlantic salmon fishing. All the frustration for a fraction of the price." Fishing for migratory fish is hard enough to predict when things are more or less as they should be, but when conditions begin to get strange, even those who know what they're doing can be at a loss. Here it was, June, when the spring run should have been just past its peak with the river full of fish, but the weather was grayer and colder than it should have been, and the rivers were still too high and chilly. Only a few small salmon were in, and even those weren't biting well. Someone suggested that the salmon either couldn't get up the rapids in the high water or just didn't want to, or that maybe the water was still too cold, so all but a few were holding back. Any or all of that meant the run would either be late or non-existent. Someone else thought the drought that past winter had dried up the streams where the shad spawn, and then the high water had blown out the remaining bait fish, leaving the salmon without their main food source. Whatever it was, the fishing had been poor enough that people had moved beyond trying to figure out why and on to why it could continue to be bad all season and possibly for years to come. Fishermen theorize desperately when they're not catching fish, especially when there's a newcomer around. They're trying to be helpful. My first landlocked salmon was 8 or 9 inches long and really was a scale model of an Atlantic salmon. Streamlined, silvery, shading to bronze on the back, with scattered spots and firm as a bratwurst. It hit hard, jumped, and fought ferociously. It did everything a baby fish could do against a 7-weight fly rod. It couldn't do much, but I was still impressed. I could see how if you put another pound or two on that fish, he could rip you a new one. I learned that in Maine, little fish are called tiddlers. I said, "Back home we just call them little fish." It went on like that for a few days. Precious few salmon were caught, and the ones we did land were mostly tiddlers. Everyone apologized for the fishing. Jim, Paul, Dave, a guy at a general store, a woman in a fly shop. "It's not usually like this," they said. I told them I understood, although in my experience, fishing for any kind of salmon is exactly like this. We fished steadily and patiently anyway, because that's what you do. You methodically go through the motions so you'll be ready if and when it happens. We'd go to a good spot, usually a stretch of slack current above or below some rapids, cast for a while, then sit and rest the spot, then start fishing again. Salmon prowl. If they're not here now, they could be here in half an hour. Or tomorrow. Or next month. This is where locals have the advantage. The same advantage I have back home. You can go home, try to do something useful, keep your ear to the ground, and come back on short notice when things turn around. As a tourist fisherman with a return plane ticket in your pocket, you suck it up and take your shot, and it's amazing how often it works out. You can't expect to hit it dead on with every trip, although that does happen now and then, and there are usually fish, and if you pay attention and bear down a little, you usually catch some. And when a trip really does go in the crapper, as one will eventually, you are still somehow fulfilling your destiny as a fisherman. And that's bound to be for the best. They said that people had fished for landlocked salmon here for 150 years, and there were no secrets left. All the good spots were known, including the most comfortable rocks to sit on. But then Jim took me to one of his favorite runs and said, "Never start in here at the same place. That way we won't wear a trail." He'd park his car far enough away to look like we'd gone somewhere else, and we'd always make sure no one was coming up or down the dirt road before we stepped off into the woods. We spent a lot of time there and always had it to ourselves. We caught a few smallish salmon, and one day I hooked and lost a big brook trout. It was 16 or 17 inches long, and I had it on just long enough to get a quick look before it spit the hook. Still, I was deeply happy to be in that country, and the long dead spells in the fishing gave me time to look around and take it all in. The woods were thick, cool, humid, and wildly diverse. There were 5 different kinds of birch tree, for instance. There were big-headed, long-necked, pileated woodpeckers with 2.5-foot wingspans lofting through the woods like pterodactyls. There were miniature clearings filled with blue and pink lupine flowers, and down along the river, you'd now and then find a single small wild iris. These were the first struggling flowers of a late bloom. According to the phenology of this river, wild irises and salmon come together. Back at the cabin, loons laughed hysterically out on Frost Pond, and at night there were tree frogs that made a noise like squirrels slowly chewing ice. At the office of the place where we were staying, I met a genuine Maine coon cat, an animal I've always admired. He was a long-haired, 20-pound bruiser with dog-sized feet and an impassive gaze. It's said that the breed originated when the cats belonging to the early settlers interbred with raccoons. That's not true, of course. In fact, it's impossible. It's just that cold climates favor large animals over small ones, from snowshoe hares to moose. This was just the North Woods megafauna version of a pussycat. It all reminded me of the boreal forests in Minnesota that I had first saw while fishing with my father on family vacations. That was where I got my first real taste for wild country, influenced not only by the lakes, woods, and fish, but by the nostalgic calendar art that hung in every cafe and hardware store at the time. You know, those idealized paintings of lean, serious men in plaid shirts and fedoras paddling wooden canoes. I was 12 or 13 years old then, more innocent than kids are now, but no less eager to lose that innocence, and I naturally imprinted on the North Woods the way an orphan gosling will fasten on the first thing it sees move. Northern Maine and northern Minnesota seem the same, because they're at opposing ends of the same primordial bioregion, and from the first day in the Maine woods, I had the eerie feeling that sometimes comes to travelers of being cozily at home in a place they've never been before. A few days into the trip, we decided we'd pounded the local water hard enough and tried another river about a 2 hours drive north. Paul kept pointedly referring to it as the river whose name must not be spoken. And I took the hint so well that now I can't remember its real name. The trip was a shot in the dark because this was a small, short stream connecting two lakes, and there were only two good pools on it. If they were already taken, as they might well have been, the long drive would be a bust. The day was dark and chilly, still dripping from the last rain and threatening more. I didn't ask if that was auspicious or not, but it's the kind of weather I've always associated with good fishing. It was easy to believe that this was, in fact, the wettest year since the Civil War, and I was jealous thinking of the drought back home. I thought, why couldn't they have a little less and we have a little more? The kind of stupid but honest question we can't help asking. I also wondered if there might be a midpoint in the nearly 2,000 miles between home with too little water and here with too much, where things were exactly right. The North Shore of Minnesota, southern Manitoba. I tried to make that an idle thought because it's deadly to start thinking you should be somewhere else when, for one reason or another, you can't be. There was an old muddy logging road along the creek. We met two fishermen coming out as we were going in, and everyone bristled harmlessly. This is public land, but every fisherman naturally thinks of the creek as his. When they'd passed out of earshot, someone mumbled that they looked like they were from New Jersey. I glanced at them over my shoulder, but didn't notice anything unusual. It turned out that the two pools Paul wanted were both open, so we spread out and started fishing. Early on, drifting an elk hair caddis with a soft hackle dropper, I landed a chubby 16-inch salmon that jumped twice and even took a little line. It was a good tussle, lasting a couple of minutes, and there was some excitement all around. But then that was it. Over the next few hours, the wind picked up steadily until casting started to get dangerous. The rain came on slowly at first, But when it built to a downpour, we trudged back to the car with hoods up on our rain slickers and our heads bowed against the wind. A little caddis hatch had been starting to come off, but the rain put an end to it. On the drive back after dark, we saw 5 moose in the road. Moose are big, but they're also black, so when they show up in the headlights at all, they're just a darker spot in the general darkness, like a hairy black hole in space, and it's possible not to see one until it's 10 feet from your front bumper. I spotted the first one when it was way too close and yelled, "Whoa!" Jim hit the brakes and said, "The proper term is moose. Whoa could mean anything." I thought we were going a little too fast, given the muddy road and the poor visibility, and since my life could depend on the proper terminology, I started silently chanting, "Moose, moose, moose." The next day, Paul and Dave went back to the river whose name must not be spoken, and Jim and I tried a couple of little streams that might have had brook trout in them, but didn't. Apparently, brook trout use the streams the same way salmon do, running up into them from the lakes only when things are damned near perfect. A friend back home had said, "I hear there's a lot of downtime to Maine fishing." I mentioned that to Jim, and he said, "Yep." That night at the cabin, the four of us compared notes, but there wasn't much to report except that Jim and I had puttered around on back roads, talking and fishing casually, and picking up the odd salmon paw or fingerling brookie, while Paul and Dave had fished long and hard and looked haggard. If the fish won't show you what they're all about, all you have to do is look at the fisherman. The 1,000-yard stare says it all, and if you're not wearing that expression yourself, it's only because you don't fully grasp the situation. Then Dave went into the kitchen to rustle up a restaurant-quality Italian meal, and over dinner we laughed about our...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.